Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. I greet you all in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I welcome all the visitors, and please enjoy the service today. Our call to worship comes from John 15, verses 4 to 5. It reads as follows. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you'll bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Credo for humans. We believe that Jesus is fully God and fully human, God in the flesh, that the Word became a human being and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. We believe in the human Christ and trust in the humanity of Christ. We believe that Jesus is the icon of the Father and in his human life associated himself with us fully. Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. Jesus revealed the way to human life. Jesus unveiled for us the truth of human life. Jesus is our life. We believe in the incarnation, that God embraced humanity and continues to embrace all people with his life and death and resurrection, calling upon his church to do the same. We believe that Jesus loves all human beings, calling upon his church to do the same. We believe that Jesus is the head of his body, the church, and that Jesus reigns in our humanness by the Holy Spirit of God. We believe that the Holy Spirit of God lives within us, empowering us to be as Jesus to all people. We believe in Jesus Christ, Lord of the cosmos and of humans, world without end.
Dear Father God, Creator of the universe and of man, Christ our Saviour, and Holy Spirit our Comforter and Teacher, we praise you for your unconditional love and kindness, your patience, grace, and care in our everyday lives. Thank you for bringing us together today as a congregation to worship you and to listen to your word. Bless Reverend John especially, and may every word he speaks be from the Holy Spirit. On behalf of the congregation, I want to pray for our leaders, whether in an administrative or political position, that each one may govern fairly and wisely. Reveal yourself to any person who does not know you yet. And to me and every Christian, make clear what my task is for today, tomorrow, and possibly in the long run. Brothers and sisters, please pray with me. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thank you.
1, verse 1 to 17. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, I have sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence, and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from bloodshed, O God, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I were to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
Revelations 12, verse 10. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven proclaiming, Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God, and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before God. Then John chapter 16, verse 7 to 15. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the thing that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. This is the word of the Lord.
A little boy visiting his grandparents was given his first slingshot. He practiced a lot in the woods, but he could never hit his target. So he came back to his grandmother's backyard, and he spied her pet duck. On an impulse, he took aim and let fly. The stone hit, and the duck fell dead. The boy panicked. Desperately, he hid the dead duck in the woodpile, only to look up and see his sister watching. Sally had seen it all, but she said nothing. After lunch that day, grandmother said, Sally, let's wash the dishes. But Sally said, Johnny told me he wanted to help in the kitchen today, didn't you, Johnny? And she whispered to him, remember the duck. So Johnny did the dishes. Later, Grandpa asked if the children wanted to go fishing. And Grandmother said, I'm sorry, but I need Sally to help make supper. Sally smiled and said, that's all taken care of, Granny. Johnny wanted to do it. Again, she whispered, remember the duck. Johnny stayed while Sally went fishing. After several days of Johnny doing all of the household tasks and Sally's, finally he couldn't stand it. He confessed to his grandmother that he'd killed the duck. I know, Johnny, she said, giving him a hug. I was standing at the window and I saw the whole thing. Because I love you, I forgave you. I wondered how long you would let Sally make a slave of you. Many of us are plagued with a nagging sense of guilt, sometimes repeatedly throughout the day. Various things make us feel guilty. But where do these feelings come from? Some of it comes from real and honest guilt. Two men were on trial for armed robbery. An eyewitness took the stand and the prosecutor moved carefully. So you say you were at the scene when the robbery took place? Yes. And you saw a vehicle leave at a high rate of speed? Yes. And did you observe the occupants? Yes, two men. And, the prosecutor boomed, are those two men present in court today? At this point, the two defendants sealed their fate by raising their hands. There are three sources of guilt. There are our expectations, number one. I crawled into bed exhausted from a long day of work and frenzied attempts to accomplish everything on my to-do list. But my mind recounted not all the work that I did, but all the work that I didn't do. Maybe you too chastise yourself with thoughts like, I should have exercised more this week, or I shouldn't have eaten that dessert, or I should be working on that project now instead of watching TV. Even spiritual disciplines can become another form of guilt-evoking list. Whatever we do, somehow it never seems quite enough. When we tie ourselves to expectations of what we want to achieve for God, we need to remember the words of Jesus to the multitude who asked him, what must we do? What must we do to do the works God requires? And Jesus replied, the work of God is this, to believe in the one that he has sent. To believe his sacrifice is sufficient is the real work to which he calls us, not the many things we busy ourselves with to gain his or others' approval. In Christ, we are already approved. Yet often we become slaves to the expectations that God never asked or required of us. The story is told about a man who entered a bar. He bought a glass of beer and then immediately threw it in the bartender's face. Quickly grabbing a napkin, he helped the bartender dry his face while he apologized with words of great remorse. I'm so sorry, he said. I have this compulsion to do this. I fight it, but I don't know what to do about it. Well, you better do something about your problem, the bartender replied. You can be sure I'll remember you and will never serve you another drink until you get help. It was months before the man faced the bartender again. When he asked for a beer, the bartender refused. Then the man explained that he had been seeing a psychiatrist and that his problem was solved. And convinced that it was now okay to serve him, the bartender poured him a drink. The man took the glass after drinking it and, well, not after drinking it, he took the glass and splashed the beer into the barkeeper's astonished face. I thought you were cured, the shocking bartender screamed. I am, said the man.
I still do it, but I don't feel guilty about it anymore. Our expectations. The other thing that accuses, that causes guilt is the accuser. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read passages such as Galatians 5, which describe the fruit of the Spirit as love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, do you ever feel overwhelmed with feelings of defeat or guilt? Perhaps you've been a Christian for 10 years, yet your life seems more aptly described by the deeds of the flesh than the fruits of the Spirit. And you receive condemning thoughts that flood your mind, such as, you'll never be free from those sins. You'll never really be what God wants you to be. You fail to show self-control once again. God is deeply disappointed in you. How long can you expect him to put up with you? These assaults are accusations, the Bible says, from our adversary, who seeks to devour us. Peter describes Satan as the one who accuses our brothers before our God day and night. Now, the accuser uses this guilt in the guise of conviction from the Spirit to imprison us and keep us bound. He taunts us with accusations like, you'll never live up to God's commands in the Scripture, so why bother reading it? But Christ stands in front of us and says, this one is my child. I shed my blood for him, for her. Though inadequate in ourselves, Jesus is our adequacy. When the accuser tries to defeat us by pointing out how far we have to go towards maturity in Christ, we can boldly state it is God's work to complete what he has begun in us. Paul says in Philippians 1 verse 6, and to make us strong, firm, and steadfast. 1 Peter 5 verse 10. I'm told that amputees often experience some sensation from their limb, their phantom limb. Somewhere locked in their brains, a memory lingers of the non-existent hand or leg. Invisible toes, they feel curl. Imaginary hands grasp things. A leg feels so sturdy, a person might try to stand on it. For a few, the experience includes pain. Doctors watch helplessly for the part of the body screaming for attention does not exist. I remember reading about a medical school administrator, Mr. Barwick, who had a serious and painful circulation problem in his leg, but refused to allow the recommended amputation. As the pain grew worse, Barwick grew bitter. I hate it, he would mutter about the leg. At last he relented and told the doctor, I can't stand it anymore. I'm through with that leg. Take it off. Surgery was scheduled immediately, but before the operation, Barwick asked the doctor, what do you do with the legs after they're removed? The doctor said, well, we may take a biopsy or explore them a bit, but afterwards we incinerate them. Barwick proceeded with a bizarre request. I would like you to preserve my leg in a pickling jar. I will install it on my mantel shelf. Then as I sit in my armchair, I will taunt that leg. Ha! You can't hurt me anymore. Ultimately, he got his wish, but the despised leg had the last laugh. Barwick suffered phantom limb pain of the worst degree. The wound healed, but he could feel the torturous pressure of the swelling as the muscles cramped, and he had no prospect of relief. He had hated that leg with such intensity that the pain had unaccountably lodged permanently in his brain. Now, to me, phantom limb pain provides wonderful insights into the phenomenon of false guilt. Christians can be obsessed by the memory of some sin committed years ago. It never leaves them. They have asked forgiveness for it hundreds of times. It can cripple their ministry. It can cripple their devotional life, their relationships with others. They live in fear that someone will discover their past. They work overtime to try to prove to God that they are repentant. They erect barriers against the enveloping, loving grace of God. And unless they experience the truth in 1 John 3:19 to 20, that God is greater than our conscience, they can become, we can become as pitiful as poor Mr. Barwick, shaking his fist in fury at that pickled leg on the mantelpiece. The third thing that causes guilt is the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said he would send a comforter who would be the Spirit of truth, who would convict us of sin, who would be a convictor. This is the only valid reason for guilt, which we are wise to hear and listen to and become aware of. The scripture says, as I said, that the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. And notice it says he will convict us, not condemn us. When the Spirit convicts us about sin in our lives, we will indeed experience regret and remorse at the gravity of our sin. But the Spirit's conviction will always come with the hope of restoration. It will always be something redemptive. The evil one wants us to wallow in our guilt, believing we have pushed God's grace beyond its limit. But someone wallowing in guilt is ineffective to God. When we wallow, we cannot act. The Spirit, as opposed to the evil one, shows us how he wants to free us, restore us, and lead us back on the path of grace and obedience. If the prodigal son had remained in the pigsty, he would never have received the love of the Father. While we need to be quick to recognize and resist condemnation and false guilt from the accuser, we must also be quick to surrender to the conviction from the Spirit. The more quickly we confess, repent, and make amends with those involved, the more quickly we can get back on the way of healing and life. My fourth point is about what needs to happen with our guilt. What needs to happen is that we need to be walking in freedom. Paul says in Galatians, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. If you're struggling with guilt and uncertain of the source, we need to ask ourselves a few questions. Number one, does this guilt drive me into God's arms for mercy and restoration, or does it drive me away, believing he condemns me and banishes me? That will be a clear determinant of the kind of guilt that we are going through. Secondly, when I tell myself I should be doing something, am I secretly hoping that by doing it, God will love me more than he already does? The motive is questionable there. Thirdly, is there a scriptural command about the act for which I'm feeling guilty? James 4 verse 17 says, anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. So, am I clearly doing something that harms my relationship with others or myself or God? Or is this something that is just an obsessive way of thinking, obsessive kind of guilt that actually undermines my relationship with God? Fourthly, what is the Spirit convicting me of today? Am I making any excuses for my actions in attempts to evade his conviction? Do I need to make amends with someone? The important thing about guilt is that we have a Lord who has taken upon himself all of our true guilt. He took everything upon himself at the cross. There's a wonderful song, and I'm going to ask Sasha to put it on the video so you can listen to it. It's very simple. It's of a homeless man who was recorded years and years ago singing a very short gospel song called Jesus' Blood. And it's put on repeat. And he basically sings, Jesus' blood never failed me yet, never failed me yet. Jesus' blood never failed me yet. One thing I know, he loves me so. You have guilt? You have a Jesus who has taken your guilt, past, present, and future. Jesus' blood never failed us yet. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that you would, by your grace, help us to deal with our guilt in a way that is redemptive. Help us to know the difference between true guilt and false guilt, and thank you for the privilege of being able to come to you with whatever guilt we have. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus' blood never failed me yet, never failed me yet. Jesus' blood never failed me yet. This one thing I know, for he loves me so. Jesus' blood never failed me yet, never failed me yet. Jesus' blood never failed me yet. This one thing I know, for he loves me so. Jesus' blood never failed me yet, never failed me yet. Jesus' blood never failed me yet. This one thing I know, for he loves me. Blood never found me yet. Jesus' blood never found me yet. This one thing I know, for he loves me so. Jesus' blood never found me. Never found me yet. Jesus' blood never found me yet. This one thing I know, for he loves me. Jesus' blood never found me yet. Never found.
Never failed me, never.
Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Amen.